Enough is enough, according to the government. Bad behaviour from state housing tenants has reached breaking point. Now it's promising a crackdown on unruly behaviour from those living in social housing. More evictions are on the way. But those people don't just disappear. So where does the Prime Minister expect them to go? And how many children will it see living on the streets? Christopher Luxon joins us now. Good morning, Mr. Luxon. How many warnings will a tenant get? Can you give us a number, please?
Well, look, ultimately that's a decision for Kāinga Ora to work out how they implement that policy. But what all we're saying is, look, when we've got really unruly, abusive, threatening tenants and KO properties, there has to be some consequences ultimately. That's the fair thing to do. It's fair to the neighbours. It's also fair ultimately to the people on the State House wait list. And so we're saying to people, look, choose to get hold up your obligations, meet your responsibilities. The vast majority of tenants do. But again, we've got to call people to responsibilities.
Yeah, so you're saying there's too much leeway at the moment, so how many warnings will a tenant get under this new crackdown?
Look, that's ultimately a decision for KO. We don't want to evict anyone from a KO house, ultimately. But if an adult is choosing to continue to engage in threatening and abusive behaviour that's impacting on their neighbours, that is unacceptable. And ultimately, there'll be a warning and a notice process and ultimately an eviction. We want to avoid that if at all possible. But I think we need to make sure that there are consequences. And it's quite interesting to me, you know, every MP in this parliament will get stories about KO communities. I had a lovely example. I was at event at Mount Smart Stadium, and I had a lovely family come up to me, and they showed me their KO house. They'd just moved in, and they were so excited, and they showed me all the photos of all the rooms inside, looking after it like it was their own, but then told me that they were getting abused by their neighbours every time they took the kids up the drive to go to school. Their washing gets taken off the line, rolled in the mud and thrown back on their balcony. Well, I'm sorry, but that has to stop. You're getting help and support from your taxpayer to get subsidised living, and there has to be a responsibility that goes with that.
Absolutely, and I don't think anybody would disagree with you. It would be awful to live next door to neighbours like that. I'm just wondering if you can give people like those people that you met some idea of how much they can expect that leash to go in terms of how many warnings they'll get, or surely can you tell me how many more evictions you might be expecting to see under this crackdown?
Well, again, it is ultimately for Kāinga Ora to operationalise the policy and the letter of intent that we've actually sent them.
But what I just say to you is, do you have an expectation around evictions?
Well, here's an example, right? For the last 3 or 4 months, we've been running at about 335 incidences of abusive behaviour. What we've then seen is over the course of the last year, I think only 3 evictions, for example, of unruly tenants. Clearly, that doesn't work. Again, we don't want to evict people from KO houses. It's a privilege to have one. We expect people to treat it as if it's their own and to be good neighbours and to be good in their communities. But I'm sorry, but where people aren't doing that, it's just not fair and it's just not right. And so we will have to have tougher consequences for that.
Okay, so 3 evictions to 300 plus complaints. What would be a ratio
per
that
month?
You would feel more comfortable with? What would be a rate of evictions that you think would match the level of complaints about unruly behaviour?
Well,
what does the advice suggest that
here,
it will do?
Yeah. So what it says is, look, you know, there has been a previous government that's had a different policy, which is actually about keeping people in their houses, irrespective of their behaviour. What we're saying to the leadership of KO, hey, listen, our letters of expectation as a government to you is that you actually can move away from that policy, because actually it's important that we hold people to account, that they take their responsibilities seriously, they get a right for a house, they have a responsibility to do the right thing by it. That's all that this is doing, all this directive or this letter is doing.
Can you tell me how many children you expect will be affected by this tightened up policy?
Look, I don't have those numbers at hand, Anna, but what I can tell you is today there are 3,500 kids that are waking up in families in emergency housing. There's 25,000 households that actually are desperate on a state house wait list to get their shot at a state house as a result. Again, as I said to you, we don't want to evict families from KO, but, you know, when adults and parents have choices and decide to make a choice not to be abusive and threatening and disruptive, the best thing is, we're setting an expectation, change your behaviour. And I just say to you, if we're in families that actually, you know, where there is extreme disruption, abuse, threatening behaviour going on, we expect our agencies to be in there supporting those children. You know, that's important. But the bottom line is, adults get to choose their behaviour and they can change their behaviour.
Yeah, can we drill down on this a bit? Because I might suggest that if adults are selfish enough to be thinking that their unruly behaviour matters more than the house over their head, even with this warning, that the children probably also haven't come first and foremost. But they are going to be the consequence of an eviction, they also will get the boot from the house. So what do you expect to happen? Because they don't just move out to another house, they go out and have nowhere to go. So where do you expect those parents with children to go with those children?
Well, I just say in those extreme situations where there is repeated abusive behaviour going on from those parents, I would say to you there could be a lot more going on in that family, and that's why we would expect our government agencies to be working with those families and with those, and looking after those children, for example, or working with those children. But I just say to you today, there are already families that are living with family and friends. They might be in emergency housing, or they might be with a community housing provider who would like a shot at their state house as well. And so in this case, what would happen is those families get a warning. They get a notice, they end up getting evicted ultimately. They end up living in the same consequences that many other families are in today that would desperately like to get onto a state house waitlist. And that may well mean living with family or friends. It might well mean living in emergency housing. I think one of the great solutions is actually community housing. Community housing providers put in a lot more pastoral care and wraparound support than we can often see in a KO community. And that's why we need both models working very strongly in the state social housing market. But I've seen those properties. You know, there's great pastoral care from folk like the Salvation Armies or Habitat for Humanity or even iwi organisations as well. So, you know, those are the raft of options. But let's be clear, there are kids waking up today living in scungy motel rooms and families that are desperate and would love their shot at getting a state house. And there are those that are waking up today that are choosing to be abusive and not hold up to their obligations. And at some point, you've got to say it's not fair, the right thing to do for the small number of people that are threatening and abusive and repeatedly behaving poorly. I'm sorry, but there needs to be consequences for that.
Do you accept community housing providers are one option, emergency housing is another, staying with families another? Do you accept that there will be families for which there are none of those options are suitable, that they will end up on the streets with nowhere to go?
Well, that's why we've got to do everything we can to avoid people getting evicted. That's why we expect adults to change behaviour. That's why we need to make sure we're doing everything we can. But at some point, at the end of the day, all of us are accountable for our choices and our decisions, and we have to step up and take responsibility for that. Yeah, and that's the central thesis here, right? That you have a right to get support in a state house, and yes, we've got to build more state houses, we've got to build access more community housing providers, we've got to do a whole bunch of work in state social housing. But you have a right to get supported when you desperately need it. But you also have a huge responsibility to be grateful, thankful, and be good citizens when you get the opportunity to have a state house. My grandmother had one all her life. I can tell you she looked after it like it was her own. I mowed the lawns every week. She was incredibly proud and incredibly grateful that the government supported her with a state house. I think, that is the vast majority of how KO tenants actually are and behave. But for the small minority that refuse to uphold their obligations, I'm sorry, there are consequences.
Talking of government support, where are you at with the police pay offer?
Look, again, police do a fantastic job. That's the police and the police association are working through that negotiation. They're doing that in good faith. We're doing our job in government to make sure that we give them the tools that they need to actually fight crime and reduce crime across New Zealand. That negotiation has been ongoing for some time. It will continue in good faith as we go forward from here.
Do you see it being resolved anytime soon?
Well, look, I really hope so. Our police do a fantastic job. We're very grateful for everything they do to keep us safe. We're trying to back them up with giving them more tools. Obviously, this negotiation is important. And I can tell you that everyone's working incredibly hard and in good faith between police and the police association. We've inherited a negotiation from the previous administration. We're going to continue to negotiate. That's all we can do.
Yeah, I think they want more money, though, not more tools.
Well, I get that, and that's what the negotiation's about, is making sure that we can work our way through what is a fair negotiation for everybody, and acknowledging where we are as a country with the set of financial situation that we have, doing the best we possibly can, and that's what we're going to continue to work with the police association around.
Other conversations you've had recently, Winston Peters, presumably about his comments in comparing the previous government to Nazi Germany. How did that discussion go?
Oh, look, had a quick chat yesterday. I talked to Winston regularly. We had a chat about it yesterday. But my bigger point from yesterday was, Chris Hipkins referring to the government as a dictatorship, the Māori Party referring to us as white supremacists. All of that language is inflammatory. It's rhetoric that's unhelpful. New Zealanders don't like it. They want us focused on the job at hand, which is looking after them. And my message to all political leaders is watch the language, because New Zealanders want us doing the business for them, not just throwing labels and language around each other.
I mean, Chris Hipkins isn't in government, neither is Te Pāti Māori. You know, this is the foreign minister, this is the deputy prime minister of this country, leading New Zealand on the world stage, making comments about comparing us to Nazi Germany, and who now refuses to accept that his comments were in any way offensive.
Yeah, well, the
surely
that
you have
I
more
don't
than a
support,
chat.
That's not what I would say. What I would say, but what I'd say to you, Anna, is every political leader needs to be called to account to say, watch the language. That's not an unreasonable thing to ask everybody across our parliament. We want civility in our politics, and the extreme rhetoric, which is trying to polarise and mischaracterise people, isn't appropriate from any political leader.
Did you make that point to Winston Peters, the way that you're describing it now publicly about what your expectation is of all leaders? Did you use those words with Winston Peters?
We had our conversation. That remains private, but rest assured, we had a chat about it yesterday afternoon.
OK, the Ipsos Monitor, the latest issues that it asked Kiwis and what they're concerned about. Inflation is still number one, the cost of living, number one across the board, no matter how you cut it. But yet Kiwis say that they rank your government's performance at 4.6 out of 10, which is barely scraping what the last Labor government was at, 4.7 right before they got the boot. Are you disappointed that you didn't get much of a honeymoon period?
Well, what I'd say is that there is 15 of the 20 issues. They believe that we're best placed to actually lead the country through dealing with those issues, which is good. The issues are the same ones that you and I have been talking about now for a year and a half, which has been fix the economy to lower inflation and the cost of living, restore law and order, deliver better public services around health and education. Those are the big five that people seem to be fixated on and focused on quite rightly. That's what our government's focused on as well. So, yes, there's lots more work to do. We're working really hard at it. You've seen us come out in 115 days and deliver our 100-day plan. We're now rolling forward into new activity for quarter two, where we're going to continue to get things done and be a government of action for people.
4.6 out of 10, though, what would you like to see that number at?
Oh, look, I don't get too hung up on polls. I'm focused on delivering outcomes for New Zealanders, and that's what we're working our way through doing. Restoring the economy, restoring law and order, rebuild it, and making sure that we deliver better health and public services and education.
Prime Minister Christopher Luxon joining us from Wellington this morning. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Anna.